Good morning.
Hello.
Welcome. Hey. Hi, Dave.
How are you?
Welcome to Broadway, whether you're here in the room with us or online. So glad that you're here today. Let's take a moment to prepare our hearts for worship, and then I'll open us with a word of prayer. God, we're thankful for a new day. God, in your word, it says that your mercies are new with every day. God, we need you. And God, I pray that as we sing today and as we celebrate who you are and what you've done, that it would bring you honor and glory. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing together. Together, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening. Thank you. draws near, and my time has come.
Still my soul.
Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and live forevermore.
Oh, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before.
Your voice
it seemed like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. God, I worship your holy name. God, I worship your
You can go ahead and have a seat. Again, welcome to Broadway Christian Church. So glad that you're here, whether you're here in the room or with us online. At this point, if you are participating in our Kid Life ministry, you can go ahead and head to the doors over there to head back to the area with our awesome volunteers and staff. You should have been handed a Connect card and this list of upcoming events when you walked in. Be sure to check that out today. This Connect card is a great way to stay connected and to update us on any info that's changed. And this is very important. Let us know how we can pray with you this week. There's also one of these cards digitally on the watch page of our website. So if you're watching online or if you're in the room and don't have one of these or just want to do that online, you can check that out there as well. If you're a guest today, welcome. So glad that you are here today. We'd love for you to fill out one of these cards with as much information as you're comfortable with. Great way for us to connect with you and you to connect with us. If you do fill out one of these, drop it in one of the offering bins by each of the exits here. Want to also let you know that Christmas Eve is December 24th this year, again, and we will have three services, 2 p.m., 3:30, and 5, and the 2 p.m. is going to have masks required. So we'd love to worship with you and your family this Christmas and to celebrate. I hope you'll join us either here for one of those services or online. Let's pray, and then we're going to start a new message series today. God, thank you. Thank you for your presence in our lives. Again, we thank you for Jesus and your grace that you've shown us through sending your son to this earth. We pray now that as we open your word together, that you would encourage us, that you challenge us, and you would help us to know the steps we need to take to be closer to you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning. If you would like to follow along with us this morning, we're going to be, for the most of the morning, we're going to be looking at John chapter 1. If you'd like to have that ready, you can follow along with us. Actually, we're going to be in John chapter 1 for the next couple of weeks. We're starting a new series this morning called Center Stage. It's going to lead us up until Christmas. So have that ready for the next couple of weeks. When I was growing up, I was never into musicals. That just wasn't one of my interests when I was a kid. But throughout the many years that I've been doing student ministry, I've had a lot of kids and students that have been participating in musicals that have really enjoyed it. And over the years, it's grown an appreciation for musicals and plays that I never once had. But the hard work that goes into the making the production what it is awesome. And the skill that it takes to learn line after line and knowing when the cues are, when to enter, when to speak, when to exit. And as Christmas is upon us now, I'm reminded of a time in every musical and in every play. There's this time after the opening song, after the characters have been introduced and talked about, after the plot line starts to form, there's this time in every play, every musical, where the lead actor or actress, the main character, goes to center stage and is in the spotlight, and they sing a solo. And all of the attention is on them. They are alone on the stage in the spotlight. And for the next couple of weeks, as Christmas rapidly approaches upon us, we're going to take a closer look at John chapter 1. Because up to this point in John chapter 1, Jesus has been talked about, he's been prophesied about, he's been hinted at, he's been pointed to, he's been waited on, and finally, after centuries of anticipation, Jesus arrives. He comes. He is here. He has taken center stage. And much like a lead actor or actress in a play or a musical, when they take center stage, much is revealed about them. And in John chapter 1, this is the same with Jesus. As he steps into the spotlight, much is revealed about him. Not only what is revealed about him, but there is a lot that is revealed through him. And this is why I love the Gospel of John, the way the Jesus arrives, the Jesus story starts here in John chapter 1. No doubt there, if you're like me, you flip through the Gospels and try to figure out what to read in at Christmas time, at the beginning of December. And if you're like me and you've done this, I can about guarantee you didn't start with John. You picked any of the other ones, you didn't pick John, because John doesn't tell the traditional Christmas story that we're used to hearing every year. It doesn't have the details that we are used to hearing. John doesn't talk about angels or stars or mangers or wise men. He doesn't talk about the virgin birth. He doesn't talk about King Herod or shepherds that came to see Jesus. No doubt those details and those stories are important, and they tell an amazing story that reveals a lot to us about who God is and his true nature. But even without the traditional Christmas story and the traditional Christmas details, John's gospel opens with one of the most elevated and profound views of God found anywhere in the Bible. Few passages in the Bible compare when it comes to expressing the divine nature of who Jesus is. No other gospel devotes as much time and as much detail when describing who Jesus is than the Gospel of John. And one of the reasons why John's gospel is like this is because John starts in the beginning. And you might think, well, all of the gospels, they start with Jesus, so isn't that the beginning? And before we get to John's gospel, I'd like to look at each of the other three gospels and kind of compare them how they begin, compare them how John begins. And so let's first look at the book of Luke, starting in chapter 1, really quick. And at the beginning of Luke chapter 1, starting with verse 13, we are told of a baby that is to come. There's this prophecy about a baby that will bring joy and gladness, and they will turn many children of Israel back to the Lord. And so in verse 13, it says, "But an angel said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayers have been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you shall call him John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will receive this at his birth. For he will be great before the Lord. He must not drink wine or strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb. He will turn many of the children of Israel to their Lord, their God.'" So Luke doesn't start with Jesus in his gospel. He starts with John the Baptist. And you might be thinking, okay, well, that makes sense because John came before Jesus, so it would make sense to start with John. He kind of made the way and prepared the way for Jesus, so this must be the beginning. But let's look at the book of Mark. Again, Mark is one of the gospels people do not typically read from around Christmas time. Again, it just doesn't have the traditional Christmas story that we're used to hearing. But Mark, if we look at the Gospel of Mark, actually starts before the book of Luke does. And in Mark chapter 1, starting with verse 1, it says, "The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, 'Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.'" So again, Mark, in his gospel, much like Luke, starts with the birth of John the Baptist. Only this time, he doesn't start with an angel foretelling his birth to his parents. He starts with Isaiah, the Old Testament prophet, back in the Old Testament. And again, that might make sense. You might say, well, John the Baptist, again, yeah, came before Jesus to make way the path straight for Jesus. So it would make sense to start in the first mention of who John is, which is in the Old Testament. One last time, let's flip to Matthew chapter 1. In Matthew, we find the most common traditional Christmas story that we hear now around this time of year. But that all happens at the end of chapter 1. At the end of chapter 1, we get the birth of Jesus and all of the things that we hear about. But I want to look at what's at the beginning of chapter 1. How does Matthew begin his gospel? And in the beginning of chapter 1, the very first verse in the Bible, we have the genealogy of Jesus. And now all of us, when we see the genealogy, we think, man, aren't genealogies great? Yeah, no one ever said that. Maybe Ian, but anyone just skips over those. But here at the beginning of Matthew chapter 1, it says this: "The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac was the father of Jacob. Jacob was the father of Judah and his brothers." Okay, so here we know that Jesus was foretold to come through the line of David, through King David. And we know that David was a descendant of Abraham. Abraham was the one that God made the covenant with, that all of the nation of Israel would be descendants from him. And these Israelites people were God's chosen people, the very people that Jesus came to reconcile back with God. So surely this is the beginning right here, and it starts with Abraham. And now I want to flip to John, and I want to compare how John begins compared to all of the rest of these. And for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be looking at John, the first chapter, verses 1 through 18. But today we're just going to look at verses 1 through 5, and this is what it says. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. The Word was God, and he was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was nothing, anything without him not was nothing anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." So in the beginning, John starts with doesn't start with the birth of Jesus. He doesn't start with John the Baptist. He doesn't start with prophecy about John. He doesn't start with Abraham. He starts from the very beginning with God, because there is nothing that comes before that. God predates everything. And you might think, well, in the beginning, that's kind of a familiar phrase. That sounds kind of familiar to me, and it should. The very first verse in the Bible, Genesis 1:1, starts with, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God hovered over the face of the waters." So in the beginning, there was nothing. There was only God. In the beginning, this is where John starts, in the very beginning. In the beginning, there was God, and there was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was there in the beginning with God. And the Word here that John is using, or that is describing, the who is here with God, the Word that John is referring to is Jesus. And we will get to why John refers to him as the Word here in a minute, but the main point I want us to take away from this beginning part of John is that in the beginning with God was Jesus. Before anything else, there was only God with Jesus. And so why is this important? If you're like me, this is kind of the first question that always pops into my mind. Someone can tell me something that I think is cool or interesting, but if it's not important, then why do we care? And the reason why this is so important that we understand that in the beginning it was God and Jesus, Jesus was with God at creation, is because there is this overwhelming misbelief that Jesus was not fully God, but yet he was just a good human moral teacher. In fact, over 50% of the adult population holds this view about Jesus, that he was just a human teacher, that he wasn't God. In fact, he was never with God. He wasn't with God at the beginning. He was never with God. That Jesus was not there with God at creation, yet instead, Jesus was a result of God's creation. And so over 50% of the adult population believes this, but you might think, well, surely Christians, the people that have studied God's word, would have a unanimous view of who Jesus is, and you would think that, but you might be wrong. That, in fact, 30% of evangelical Christians believe this same view, that Jesus was not God, he was just a human, and it was not there with God in the beginning. And this is a huge problem, that over one-third of Christians, just like those of you in this room, hold the view that something that directly contradicts what Scripture says. Because notice here that the Word wasn't just with God at creation, that the Word was God. And at first glance, readers might be swayed at this beginning part of John into thinking of a Unitarianism view of God, meaning that there's just one God in one form. But if we read this at the beginning, that the Word was God, in the original language, it does not allow for this view. In fact, reading this this scripture in a Unitarianism view overlooks the stress that's put on of the relationship between God and the Word in the beginning, where it says that the Word was with God and that he was in the beginning with God. And that the phrase that the Word was God is simply just John emphasizing the godliness of Jesus, that everything that God is, Jesus is as well. And this isn't, we don't just see this in the Gospel of John, we see it throughout the New Testament. In John chapter 20, verse 28, it says, when Jesus reveals himself to Thomas for the first time after his resurrection, Thomas answers him, "My Lord and my God." In Titus 2, verse 13, it says, "Waiting our blessed hope, the appearance of our of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ." Now, if you attended Ian's Wednesday night Bible study a couple months ago on the book of John, you might remember Ian talking about the Grainsville Sharp rule. And this is a rule in the Greek language, much like English. The Greek language has grammar rules that we have to follow when reading things. And this is one of those rules, and it shows up here in Titus chapter 2, and it also shows up again in 2 Peter chapter 1. And in both of these scripture, you will read the phrase, "our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ." And when reading this, and if you're just reading this normally without any other prior study on what this might mean, there's two ways to read this. One of them is to read them as our great God and our great Savior. Two separate people. But the Grainsville Sharp rule rules this out. And it forces us to read both of these scriptures as one person, our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus is both. Jesus is God. And it is here where John starts to describe who Jesus is. And as I mentioned before, John's description of who Jesus is more elevated and divine than anywhere else in Scripture. And like I said, through this first five verses, John begins to describe Jesus, and then he describes Jesus in three different ways with three different words. So number one, Jesus is the Word. And we already talked about how John refers to Jesus as the Word, but we didn't cover why. Why does he call Jesus the Word, and why doesn't he just call him by his name? And to do that, to answer this question, we have to look at the Word itself. We have to look at the word, Word. And this word used here to describe who Jesus is in the Greek language is logos. And this is the only place in the Bible where Jesus is referred to as the Word, verses 1 through 14. No other book in the Bible refers to Jesus as the Word. And to the Greeks and to the Jews both, they would have had an idea of this concept of logos. And it would have been more of a concept than a definition or a title. The Greeks' concept of what the logos is a divine rationality. It's a divine mind, a divine principle of the entire universe. You know, the Greeks had their gods and they believed in their power over what they had power over, but the logos is what controlled everything. The logos is what made the earth spin and what made the sun rise. The logos was in control of the world. It was this governing power of everything. The Jews also had their concept of the logos, and it was God. And they knew God as the Word because that is how the universe was created, by his words. That's how they knew him. By his words, the universe was created. By his words, he was healed. People were healed. By his words, the law was put into place. By his words, God revealed himself to the people. And so John, here at the beginning of his gospel, takes the Greek concept of logos and the Jewish concept of logos, this ever-powerful being, and what the Jews thought of as God, and combined them together into define who Jesus is. Jesus is someone who was there at creation and controls everything. Jesus is God. Number two, in verse 4, it says, he is the life, and the life was the light of men. And this makes sense because Jesus was there at creation. He created everything. He is life. No one gave him life. No one created him. And so this means that he is the essence of life. And not only is he the creator of life, he is the giver of life. In John chapter 11, Jesus hears of a man named Nehemiah who is so ill that he's on the brink of death. And Nehemiah is actually... Lazarus, I need to look at my notes. Lazarus is who we're talking about. Lazarus is a man that Jesus is later described as the one Jesus loved, the one who Jesus loved. And by the time Jesus got to where Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. But because Jesus is the giver of life, he was able to command Lazarus by his words to come out of the tomb that he was laid in, and life again was restored to him. In Mark chapter 5, Jesus is told about a little girl who was so ill that she too was at the point of death. And this girl's daughter was the ruler of the synagogue, but yet he still came and he laid at the feet of Jesus, imploring him to come and lay his hands on her so that she may live once again, because Jesus is the giver of life. And Jesus is not only the giver of physical life, not only through creation, but his time here on earth, but Jesus is the giver of spiritual life. And we are told many times throughout Scripture that we at one point are dead in our sins, that we are spiritually dead. In Ephesians 2, it says, and you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you once walked. In Romans 6:23, it says, for the wages of sin is death. But even though at one point in our lives we are spiritually dead because of our sins, Jesus is the giver of not only physical life, but spiritual life, and he is able to overcome the power of sin, overcome the power of death, and restore life to us once again. In Ephesians 2, it says, we were once dead in our trespasses, but in verse 4, God being rich in mercy and because of his great love in which he loves us, even when you were dead to your trespasses, made you alive again together with Christ. And in John 3:16, we all know this one, but for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. Jesus is the giver of life through creation, but he's also the giver of life through the cross. Number three, Jesus is the light. And in him was light. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And Jesus is the light of men, and we've certainly heard Jesus referred to many times in the Bible as the light. In fact, Jesus refers to himself in John 8 as the light of the world. And again, there's certainly an allusion back to creation. John just keeps going back to this beginning in which he starts, the beginning of the world, where there was only darkness. And by God's word, he made light, and the light overcame the darkness. At no other point is it more appropriate to say that the light shines in the darkness than in creation. And when talking about creation, talking about physical darkness, Darkness is simply just the absence of light. That when we have darkness and light, we'll overcome it because darkness is just the absence of light. But John just isn't referring to physical darkness here. He's talking about physical darkness, but spiritual darkness as well. He's talking about sin. He's talking about evil that's in this world. And this is a theme that goes throughout the book of John, this ever-present duality of evil versus good and light versus dark. And when it comes to spiritual darkness, it's not just simply the absence of good, like physical darkness is. Spiritual darkness is a positive evil. It seeks to overcome the light. It seeks to overcome good. And we as sinful people, we like to live in the dark. And no one will ever admit that, especially not Christians, but it's true. And I say this because whenever light is shown on our darkness, whenever our evil deeds are exposed or our evil lifestyle is questioned, we hate it. We hate the light that shines on our darkness and exposes it. And it's this light that shines in the darkness and it shows us how dark we really are. And we hate that. And we would much rather just live in the darkness. It's so much more simple. It's so much more easy and comfortable. And no matter how hard we try to hide the darkness in our lives, it's the light that exposes the darkness. And through this, our eyes are opened to who Jesus really is. And the only way we are able to see the evil that is in our life is because we are able to see the righteousness of Jesus. And it's because of this that we are able to see who God really is. And what John is referring here to as Jesus being the light is what we call general revelation. That our eyes are now open to the truth about God simply because of who Jesus is. That before we were blinded by our darkness, but now through Jesus, we are able to see God and we are able to know God. You know, Jesus is the light, and he doesn't shine light on himself. He shines light on God. He points to God, not himself. And remember in the beginning when I said that when Jesus steps into the spotlight, things are revealed through him. And when Jesus finally here in John chapter 1 steps into the spotlight, onto center stage, Jesus shows us who God really is. Not only does Jesus, the light, shine in the darkness, but the darkness does not overcome it. And in the Greek word here used for overcome is the word we use for grasp. And this could mean two different things. It could mean to grasp intellectually, to understand something, or it could mean to take hold of, to grab, but with hostility. And John, throughout his gospel, he uses this word three times, and every single time it is meant with hostility, that the darkness is unable to overcome light, that evil is unable to overcome who Jesus is and hide who God is. If we really want to know who God is, all we need to do is look to Jesus. Jesus is the one who has opened our eyes and has shined the light on the true nature of God. And instead of leaving us searching around in the darkness, aimlessly wandering, God has sent his light to point light back to him so that we can know who God is through Jesus Christ. And what an incredible gift that is. And as we enter into this time where gifts and other things are constantly at the forefront of our mind, let us be remembered of the gift that God has given us, not of eternal life through his son, but that he sent his son to shine light back onto him and that we can know who God is. Let's pray. God, we are here this morning and we have so much to be thankful for, that you have given us so much. We are thankful for everything that you have done for us, everything that you have given to us. And you've sent your son, not just to reconcile us back to you, but that we can actually know who you are through him. And God, as we enter into this time of communion, let us remember the gift that you have given, that we are actually able to be with you once again, that we are dead once to our sins, to the evil things that are in our lives, but God, you offer us forgiveness, and we thank you so much for that. God, we thank you for everything that you have done, for everything that you are, and what you have done for us, and it's your son's name. Amen.
worship together.
You came down to a world that was fallen and hopeless to bring peace, to bring love, to bring joy to the nation. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath.
As we enter into a new season and a new year, we want to take this opportunity to encourage you to give first with this new season. That for many of us, this past year has been a time of uncertainty, but the truth is that all times are uncertain, and the only thing that we can hold true tightly to remain true and constant is the gospel, and that the gospel, everything that it means and it stands for, should be evident in everything that we do. In Colossians 1:18, it says, "And he is the head of the body, the church, and he is the beginning and the firstborn among the dead, so that everything he might have supremacy." You know, all things were created through God, and all things are created for him as well. And so we say all the time around Broadway that giving is an opportunity for you to serve, and so we want you to take this opportunity to worship with us. Your generosity fuels everything that we do at Broadway, that to help people find a hope in Christ and a home in his church. And so remember, if you would like to give today, there are a couple ways you can do that. One is on our website at broadwaycc.org/giving. You can also text any dollar amount to 84321. And if you're here with us this morning, you can drop it off in the bins at the doorway as you leave. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to sing one more song as we close. God, we just thank you so much this morning, and we praise you for everything that you are and everything that you have given to us, that we are so thankful for everything that we have. And at this time, we just give back to you to show our praise for who you are and what you've done for us. And it's your son's name. Amen.
It's been such a pleasure worshiping with you today. Let's stand and sing one last song. Here we go.
With this heart open wide, from the depths, from the highs, I will bring a sacrifice. With these hands lifted high, hear my song, hear my cry, I will bring a sacrifice.
It will be my joy to say, "Your